You want to find the polar representation of the equation y squared minus x squared is equal to 4. So you want to find the polar equation. So the first thing that you would do, you would substitute the x and y coordinates in terms of polar representation coordinates. Okay, so you know that x is equal to r cosine theta and y is equal to r sine theta. This is what you should memorize. This is the polar representation of the coordinates x and y. So now, if you want to find the polar equation equivalent to this xy equation, you would simply plug this polar representation coordinates into the equation given. So that would give you r sine theta squared minus r cosine theta squared is equal to 4. And the left side simplifies as r squared sine squared theta minus r squared cosine squared theta is equal to 4. We can take the r squared outside. We will have sine squared theta minus cosine squared theta is equal to 4. And further, you can use the half angle formula for the sine squared theta and the cosine squared theta. So you're going to get r squared sine squared theta is equal to 1/2 1 minus cosine 2 theta, and then minus, and then the cosine squared theta is equal to 1/2 1 plus cosine 2 theta. Okay, and that's equal to 4. So now we're going to have 1/2 minus 1/2, right? So that will be equal to 0. So then we're going to have negative 1/2 cosine 2 theta, negative 1/2 cosine 2 theta again is equal to 4. And as I just said, 1/2 cancels out with a negative 1/2 is equal to 0, right? So we don't have to worry about that constant. So now we're going to have r squared, and guess what happens? Negative 1/2 coefficient added with a negative 1/2 coefficient of the same cosine 2 theta is basically negative cosine theta. Cosine 2 theta, right? The resulting coefficient is negative 1 when you add the negative 2/2. Then that's equal to 4. So now the r squared is equal to 4 divided by negative cosine 2 theta. So now this is where you have to be careful. Notice that r squared does not equal to a positive number. Okay, so for this reason, when you solve for r, you're going to take the square root on both sides. You will make sure, well, first of all, notice that 4 divided by negative cosine 2 theta is written as 4 negative secant 2 theta. Okay, that should be clear, right? Because 1 divided by cosine is secant. So now if you take the square root on both sides, you're going to have to make sure that you have plus and minus. Okay, and I will explain to you why plus and minus has to be done here. So you will have plus and minus square root. Before the square root, we have a 2 in there, right? Because square root of 4 is 2. And then we have the square root minus secant 2 theta. You might be a little bit surprised. You might say, wait a second, but there's a negative sign. How are we going to make sure that there's no negative inside the square root? It's still correct. The only thing you have to watch out for, you have to make sure that the negative secant 2 theta is positive. And believe me, it's possible. It depends on the angle theta. So we have to make sure that the negative secant 2 theta, okay, is greater than 0. So that means that secant 2 theta, if you multiply both sides of the inequality by the negative 1, will be less than 0, right? Because the direction changes, the sign changes direction, right? So so now secant 2 theta is less than 0. And as you know, secant follows the same signs patterns in terms of the quadrants as cosine, right? Because it relates to cosine. So, and we know that cosine is negative because we need less than 0. We know that cosine 2 theta is negative in quadrants 2 and 3, right? So the same thing is for the secant. So that means the angle 2 theta, because treat this as one full angle, 2 theta, right? That's the angle we're talking about, is actually enclosed in the interval pi over 2, okay, from pi over 2 until 3 pi over 2, right? Because that pi over from pi over 2 to 3 pi over 2, you have exactly quadrants 2 and 3. So now dividing both sides of this inequality by 2, you will get pi over 4, okay, is less than theta, is less than 3 pi over 4. So there it goes. Now I will show you why this equation that you found, this polar equation, this polar equation that you found corresponds to what you should see. First of all, let's understand what this y squared minus x squared is, okay? This given equation. This is the equation of the hyperbola. Okay, if you plot this in the xy plane, okay, you can basically, you don't have to worry about the a and b and so on and so on. You can just play around with the x's and y's. If you let x is equal to 0, y squared is equal to 4. So y will be plus minus 2, right? So when x is equal to 0, y is plus minus 2. So that's something that you immediately see. So you can plot those points, okay? Now when x is equal to 1 or negative 1, right? Because x is squared, so it's not going to change the result for the y. So when x is equal to 1 or negative 1, y squared will be equal to 5, right? Because you will add that 1 in order to get rid of the negative 1 on the left side. So y squared will be positive 5 anyway, even when x is equal to negative 1. So that means y will be square root of positive plus minus square root of positive 5. And you know that positive square root of 5 is greater than 4, right? Because square root of 4 is 2, so square root of 5 is greater than 4, so square root of 5 is greater than 2, the square root of 4. So that means it's somewhere here, right? And the same thing and since it's plus and minus, you're going to have symmetry with respect to the x-axis, right? So as you can see, and the same thing, there's symmetry with respect to the y-axis, because x can be negative 1 as well. It will give you the same y value, right? And same thing here because of the plus and minus, right? So as you can see already, you're talking about a hyperbola. This is the equation of a hyperbola that looks something like this, okay? That looks something like this. So now if you want to understand why we're including plus and minus 2 radical negative secant 2 theta, I want you to take a look at this. Remember that I just told you that we have a constraint here, right, for the angle theta from pi over 4 to 3 pi over 4. And guess what? It matches what you see here, because pi over 4, right, think of it as an asymptote, is exactly this line. Okay, and I didn't draw this exactly well, but I will probably just correct it. I want you to see that it will actually approach this asymptotic line. And the same thing for the 3 pi over 4. So I will correct this arrow and make sure that it will approach those asymptotic lines. Okay, but anyway, so as it goes like that, it will approach the asymptotic line. It will never hit it, but it will approach it. So this is 3 pi over 4 asymptote. So as you can see, this will approach the asymptotic line, okay, this hyperbola. And the same thing, now you might say, but what about the negative part? Aren't we just talking about pi over 4, from pi over 4 to 3 pi over 4? How does this side fit in? How does this hyperbola fit in? This half of the hyperbola, how does that fit in? But I will explain to you. So if we take the if we break this down into parts, we take the r is equal to 2 radical negative secant 2 theta. If we test the theta using pi over 4 here, okay, I will mark this theta is equal to pi over 4. Theta is equal to 3 pi over 4. Well, maybe should write it a little below. Theta is equal to 3 pi over 4, right? These are the asymptotic lines. So if we take the first case where the coefficient is positive, if we let pi over 4 be the angle, well, let's try pi over 2 because that's the easier one, right? That's where we have the landings plus minus 2, okay, for the radius. So if we let theta is equal to pi over 2, the result will be, I will write this in red, okay, the radius as a function of theta pi over 2 is going to be 2 times negative secant 2 times pi over 2, okay? And what is that going to be? 2 times pi divided by 2 is pi. Secant of pi is negative 1, just like the cosine, right? Because secant is 1 over cosine. And negative 1 multiplying this negative coefficient gives you positive 1. And square root of positive 1 is 1. 1 times 2 is, guess what, 2. So that makes sense with the fact that we have this 2 point here when the angle is pi over 2, right? Because at the y-axis, the positive y-axis, the angle theta is pi over 2. Okay, and now so as you can see, we're definitely talking about the upper part of the hyperbola, upper half for this radius equation. But if we take the negative radius equation, we will have this, right? Negative 2 square root negative secant 2 theta. So if we test the negative pi over 2, well, actually, if we test the pi over 2 one more time, we'll get negative 2 times negative secant of pi over 2. So what is that going to give us? This is going to give us 1, as we decided, but 1 will multiply the negative 2, so it's going to give us negative 2. And that makes sense, right? Because your point for this would be negative 2. And this is where it gets interesting. This is totally justified because even though the angle measure is pi over 2, since the radius is negative, it's a negative radius, we must switch directions, right? And the opposite direction of pi over 2 is exactly 3 pi over 2, right? Which is this, okay? The negative y-axis, right? This is 3 pi over 2. So that's why we're landing on negative 2 for the y value here instead of the positive, because the radius is negative. So when the radius is negative, we switch directions. Okay, and for this reason, we have the symmetry, and for this reason, we also going to have the continuous asymptotic line for the angle theta pi over 2, pi over 4. The same thing is going to be for 5 pi over 4, right? Because we're also going to talk about negating the radius is in the same cases, but for the different theta values, which is why we will have negations similar to the pi over 2 case, right? So that's why we have to kind of continue these asymptotic lines all over the place, okay? And that makes sense with the fact that we will have forever going symmetric parabolas, right? And that these symmetries of the parabola in both cases here makes it obvious that this is a hyperbola that we're talking about, okay? Hyperbola that will approach this asymptotic lines as x approaches infinity and negative infinity as well, okay? So I hope that you found this video useful. Please subscribe, and I'll see you in my next video.